Hello and welcome. I'm very glad that you are here. Today I'll be talking about our experiences with using Flink for more than a year as a main processing framework. So, my name is Sebastian Czarnota. I'm working in Polish startup on digital fingerprints product. Digital fingerprints is a continuous authentication framework. I'm a system architect there. I'm responsible for correct, fast, and reliable data processing in our product. Well, there's a problem with authentication. Every day, we are using lots of services that require us to log in somehow. And very often, we probably leave our systems unprotected. So, as you can see, the least several thing, severe thing that may be happening to us is that our colleague is doing us some joke. But when it comes to protecting our, for example, bank accounts or secrets of our companies, it's not so amusing. So we are trying to solve that problem by developing continuous authentication framework, which is an extension of standard login by the constant verification of the user session. We are constantly monitoring if user behaves in the same way how he behaved in the previous sessions. So instead of a single point of login, we are continually check his sessions. We are using passive behavior analysis for that. So our user plugin, which is in user when a web service is integrated with our user plugin, it sends us anonymized data about this user's behavior. We analyze it using mainly Flink and return the score that describes how much person is similar to his previous behavior. So I'd like to start from explaining what goals we set for our project, because it very much impacts the technical decision we've made and system design at all. So the most important for us is to make that user data are private. So we care about our users' privacy and rights. We are compliant with GDPR legislation. GDPR is a European Union legislation that conforms to all companies that do data processing of personal information. We are trying to be as personal information free as possible because of this anonymization phase. And thanks to that, our consent requirements are limited. Another goal, very important for us, is seamless integration of our framework to our partners' systems. So we are making sure that there is no visible changes in UI of web services that uses us. We try to optimize our way of gathering the data and anonymization phase. We make sure that required network traffic is optimized. And we try to work in all current modern systems. Another very important for us is easily being integrated with existing web services. So we are setting some simple yet powerful REST APIs. We can work in two models, in pooling mode when our partner asks us about some specific session, and we are responding with the score describing how much this behavior is typical. And we can work in pushing mode, which when we alerting users about some suspicious sessions. Pushing mode wouldn't be possible without Flink. And last but not least, and this is probably the most impactful requirement for a Flink application, we have to have very fast reaction time. So by reaction time, I mean the time between the moment when someone's session is hijacked to the moment when we can generate alert for that session. So this, this reaction time consists of Flink latency, so how long we process data through Flink, plus the inertia of machine learning models when they know that behavior changed. So, you know goals. Let's go to some views on the system that was most impacted by those goals. So, first of all, the most important thing you have to decide at the beginning of developing Flink application is how to advance time. As you probably know, that Flink can work in three time characteristics: it's processing time, ingestion time, and event time. Selecting one of them tells how Flink internally advances time, and this impacts performance, impacts for us, we found that it very strongly impacts testability of whole application. And as you may see in the in a few minutes, that there is more things that depends on that. So key requirements here is, as I said, low latency, is scalability, because we want to be able to handle growing number of users for our partners, and we want to be able to time travel. By time travel, we are thinking that this is the feature that we can reprocess all the data again, slightly differently, to see what we could do better. So, what's the difference between running application online to the possibility of doing the reprocessing? So, there's lots of that data stored when we are doing reprocessing. And instead of processing data as they come to our system, we are just cramping all events together and gets processed faster. We are doing this mainly for machine model learning improvements and for experiments with new machine learning features. To better understand the differences between time characteristics, let me present you the message lifetime. When there is some event that occurs in user system, we describe this event to the data structure called message, and we assigned to this message timestamp called event time of the moment where the event occurred in the user system using user system clock. This is important. And next step, we are sending this message to our system, and our first boundary system attaches another timestamp to this message called ingestion timestamp. Next, this message is put into some queue, and when its time goes, it is processed, and this time is called processing time. So the most simple way of using advancing time in Flink is using processing time characteristic. So all these timestamps from user event time and ingestion time are not used, only the processing time. So only the system clock time of the machine where the Flink application is run. However, there is a big drawback, because when we have time-based operations, like here, you see this these time windows are the same in processing time. However, the events are cramped together. So we are not getting the same layout of windows using processing time in reprocessing schema. So this is not good for us. However, plus is that it's simple and very performant. However, we are getting not deterministic results. And it's hard to test processing time timers. However, I want to remark one thing, because of the first day of this presentation, they taught us about additional internal testing features that Flink community uses, and they have a mocks for processing time testing. So, but also they said that it's internal project and may change over time, so I don't know if I want to use it for production testing. So that's just, I want to remark this here, that there are some ways to process processing time in Flink. Another, the most probably often used time characteristic is event time characteristic. This is, as you can see, the time windows are having the same events using online processing and reprocessing. However, So we are getting the deterministic results when we are using event time characteristic. And it's very easy to test because we just have this event time timestamp into our message. So we can, in test, put there anything. So testing is easy. However, there is a very big problem with that approach. You may know, we have lots of users connected to our system, and we found that all systems that are throughout the internet, all our users have a slight different type set in their systems. This might be drift in some, 200 milliseconds. However, for us, for processing in Flink, it's very huge, and we cannot allow that. Because the standard way to coping with that problem in Flink, using event time, is to adding some time lag. So you know how watermarks works in Flink, probably. This is when first event time message comes into system, this is the moment that says, from this message, advance internal time. However, all messages that comes into system and has timestamp lower than this internal watermark are discarded because they get to system too late. So the standard approach is to add some time lag. So we are not using new events timestamp, but new timestamp minus this time lag. But if you think about it, we are by this increasing our reaction time because it increases internally latency. So this is also not good for us. And there's another risk, security risk for Flink application. Because think about a rogue user who changes its system time on purpose to some further time. And when we use it as a source for our internal Flink timer, we move internal Flink timer further, and it will mess up our processing at all. So we cannot do event processing time securely by taking other systems' times as a source of Flink internal advanced time. So it is not good for us. Another approach is to use ingestion time characteristic. It's taking not the event time from the moment when the event occurred in user system, but the time when a message reaches Flink application. So there is the moment when a message goes into the Flink application, there is automatic assignment of the timestamp, and Flink from this point uses processing as it was event time processing. So we are getting here, we control source of time, comparing to previous result, it is very good. However, we're still getting not deterministic reprocessing because when we are doing loading all our data from a data lake is our long-term data store, we are getting these messages cramped together all the way the same as in processing time. So this is not the good approach again. And wall processing, wall pipeline tests are also hard to do because of this processing time impact. So we have to think about something completely different. We divided our Flink application into two pipelines that are synchronized at the middle with special Kafka topic. So we do the ingestion time characteristic first. So when message enters our system, we assign ingestion time to every message. And this is all job that this pipeline has to do. So we are getting message, we assign this our time from our system, so we know this clock can be trusted. Then we are moving this to the topic, and then all the further processing can be done in event time securely. Thanks to that, we are getting a characteristic of time operations similar to event time. However, without this depends on external clocks. So we control source of time, we have stable reprocessing, we achieve our data with fixed timestamp. This is very interesting because when we, as you can see in the previous picture, we are moving this data into data lake at this point. So when we do reprocessing, we just change the direction of this arrow, feed the data backward, and do reprocessing with the same on the feature extraction phase. There is no difference when we are operating. So it's very good for us. And it's very easy to track reaction time in online because reaction time measurement is computed by dividing current system processing time minus this ingestion time from the boundary system. So we are getting it very easily. However, the one drawback of this approach, besides it's complicated in deployment, is that reprocessing in reaction time is not correct. Because when we are reprocessing data, for example, from last week, we are getting in our reaction time this 1 week intrinsically added. So, however, we are not using reprocessing procedure to measuring our load capabilities. We have other procedures for that. So, summing up, keep in mind your requirements when you are selecting time characteristic. It's very good to know all drawbacks of different approaches. And I think it's very good to know that you can combine them to construct something more tailored to your needs. Also, we found that selecting particular time characteristics have a big impact on possibility of testing, but doing whole pipeline tests, not only operator tests. We are focusing on the first one. And I think that you have to watch out on checkpointing interval. I'd like to digress here. We've burned once $1,000 in a day because of forget to turn off checkpointing when we was doing reprocessing in our feature extractors. So it was checkpoint was written in the HWS, so it was very quick to burn a lot of money. So and in such scenarios, you don't need checkpointing turned on at all when you are doing small experiments, because if something went wrong, you just run it again. So another case that impacted our system design is we want to be compliant with GDPR. As I mentioned before, GDPR is European Union legislation that all companies that work with personal data has to conform to. There is no option. So the biggest requirements from the technical perspective is ability to delete data of single user when this user asks us about to remove it. Also, there is a requirement to move all users' data to some other service provider. Another requirement is to hold raw data for extended period of time. This is especially when you are doing automatic decision making on data you are collecting. We are doing this so because of alerting and being possibly closing some users' sessions. And also, it's not technical, but there's a number of consents we have to process behavior data. There are different sets of consents for processing behavior data and for personal data. For personal data, there is much more hard to get. It's harder to have this consent. It's harder to technically keep it because of requirements on your data storage, security of this data, and so on. So let me start from the end, but because by anonymization our data, we are making our solution don't need to have consent for processing personal data. How we do it? As you can see, we are interested in user behavior dynamics. We are not interested what user wrote in a specific edit box, but how he written it. So we are getting only the time characteristics between pressing each mouse click, how he moved mouse, and how he reads on a keyboard. What is the time characteristic of writing on the keyboard? So we are not gathering users' login and passwords. Well, another way, you have to about places when you can leave your data users' data in Flink application. And well, there's a need of clearing all data for selected user when he needs to. To do it is think about all places when this data is stored. So for example, there's user data in Flink sessions for our application, because we are our data streams are keyed by session IDs. So all information from selected user is maybe keyed in some states. So it's very important to clear states when the sessions are finished. You can use timers for that and some other inactivity markers. However, it was at this conference that they told a lot about time to live option on state variables. It's good to have it. I said we can't wait for it, because as I inquired data artisans a little bit more, currently it only works on processing time. So we have to still wait until Flink 1.7 to be able to do it on event time processing time applications. And also, it would be nice to, well, currently we are using lots of timers to solve this problem. So it would be nice to have some possibility to unregister all timers that are before some given timestamp at once. It would be a good feature for us, I think. As I said, data lake is a long-term data storage for data. In data lake, we are keeping data of all this raw data about user behavior. So we hold it for machine learning research, for model training for specific users, and for legal purposes, I said before. So basically, if you see these requirements, if you index your data by user ID, everything else is very easy to do. Removing and moving is simple. However, you need to have indexable and accessible by index ID data store, data lake. We tried to use Kafka as our data lake at the beginning, and we found that there is no easy way to remove single key from Kafka topic easily. So we have to move to another technology. So another thing we have to remove when user asks is his machine learning models. We are holding them not in data lake, but in some other system. And because we are doing training models per user, it's not that we have one or 100 models for everything. We have few models for every user, and we periodically retrain these models. So it's lots of computing power to train these models. However, we are having all models indexed by user ID thanks to that. So it's easy for us to have this kind of removing these models when they are when a user asks about it. There are another way, place when user data can leak into our system. There are echoes of user activity in our system, even if this data is removed. So the most obvious one are matrices and summaries we are doing. However, there's a residual impact of user behavior on all other behaviors. Why? Because the way we are doing machine learning, we are just comparing user behavior with all other user behaviors. So when we remove other user, for example, the red one, so all other models, until they are retrained, depends on this deleted data. However, this residual impact cannot be used to find this user, because it's very, it depends, but we cannot grasp what part of this counter class comes from this deleted user. This residual effect fades over time, because we are doing periodic retraining of all models. And what is good, that residual effect is not against the legislation, because we can over time remove not everything at once. So summing up is very short. Just index your data by user ID and be able to remove it, and you are you can comply with GDPR from technical perspective. Last case I'd like to tell about is generating machine learning features. Well, what is a machine learning feature for us? This is the single input to machine learning model that generates score. By score, I mean the measure that tells us how this user behavior from current session is similar to his previous behavior seen in other sessions before. So, because we are trying to catch a user's behavior dynamic, we cannot just every user treat as a single feature. It won't give us good results. So we have to somehow group events and generate from this group single feature. Flink gives us several ways of doing this, but let me move a little bit before Flink. We used before our custom solution for that. We thought that it would be enough to provide the score on demand. So when our partner asks about some session, we take all events, process it through our models, and generate model score at this point. So, despite it's very cheap, because we are doing only those computations we need to do, however, it gives us very high latency, because we have to reprocess all data at one point, and user waits for that at the time, and we are getting non-deterministic latency, because the longer the session becomes, the longer the processing takes. And we cannot work in pushing mode, so we cannot set that there is an alert on this session if user not asks us about this particular session. This was the moment we choose to find some pure stream processing framework, and this was the moment when we selected Flink. So, how to group events in Flink? Windows, the simplest way to do it. We have tumbling windows. As you may know, tumbling windows is a periodic window that fires every X seconds, and all events are grouped from this last X seconds. Consecutive windows do not overlap, so you have a window and this feature every X seconds. It was quite cheap, because we was processing only limited amount of data in each window. However, we've got very poor machine learning results from this kind of approach. And we've got very few features. As you see, we was getting one or two features every 50 seconds, despite how many models for user we used. Another logical stop was to use sliding window. Sliding window is very similar, but windows overlap for each other for some time. For example, when we have sliding window 50 seconds, 1 second, it means that we are having 50 second windows, and every 1 second we generate a new one. This was giving us more features. However, it was still, and it started to become computationally intensive. However, still, machine learning result wasn't good. We found at this point that it might be because of the fact that a variable number of events construct a single feature. So we thought that it might be the case. However, before I go to the solution, let's think about session windows. Session windows in Flink are a little bit different, because the windows are closed when there is some time of inactivity on given stream. So, for example, if we have session gap set to 15 seconds, every time we need to wait 50 seconds until the window is closed. So we are increasing our latency time by 50 seconds by default, which is very good, not good in our approach. It was quite light computationally, but if reaction time was extended by 50 seconds by default. It was we cannot use it. And again, we would get the variable number of events using this approach. So the final solution was to write some custom triggers. It's process functions that store all events that came, and we make sure that we are generating only set number of events to construct feature. So it's very computationally intensive because we are doing a lot of machine learning feature extractions. However, we have a constant number of events in each feature. We are getting no latency slowdowns thanks to this approach, because as fast we are getting the nth event, and n is the number of events that construct single feature, we generate it right away. So no slowdowns. We have lots of features in this approach. You know, if all other things are met, we are generating for every keystroke, for example, new feature, until some other cases are not occur. And we've got at last good machine learning features from this approach. We started to differentiate users from each other. So to sum up, event grouping doesn't end in Flink on standard Windows. There is much to take from this process functions, and you can also use the intermediate API for that, because Flink has custom windows. It's called global window, and there you can write your custom triggers and custom evictors, which also allows you to do very complicated grouping. However, we found that writing triggers and evictors to reach this what we've got from process function required more code and was more error prone. So sometimes this lower level API as process function is better. So let me conclude this presentation with thanks to great Flink community. I'd like to thank very much for deployment improvements, because from Flink 1.6 it became very easy to deploy Flink applications. Well, the number of WTFs from our DevOps team decreased significantly from that. We are waiting for the state option for time to live on event time. It would be nice to have, as I mentioned before, this possibility to better manage your timers. And I think that Flink is lacking this testing utilities for processing time applications and some custom watermark extractions. But we know right now that there have some libraries, internal libraries for that, so there is something you can do. Thank you very much for your attention, and if you have any questions, I'd like to respond to them.
Thank you very much, Sebastian. Do you guys have any questions from the audience? Yeah.
Hi, thank you for the presentation. If you're using the ingestion time, mm-hmm. how do you handle late data or out of order events?
Well, we are doing our grouping, and mainly we are using this time for managing the eviction of events from our state when session is offline. Because for constructing features, we are still using users users event time. You know, we cannot trust user time for internal Flink time advancement. However, we have to take user system time to do our timing their behavior. Because there is no possibility to, you know, translate from one time domain to our time domain. So we are doing two different time domains. All Flink operations are based only on our timers. However, when it comes to feature extraction, we switch this in process function to think only in the user time, user system times. So we have two notions of time. Each, thank you.
If I can, another question. You said that your data lake is indexed by user ID.
Yes.
Isn't that difficult if you have like millions of users and so your, you can say partitions are very small. Mm-hmm. I'm wondering like how do you do it if your data lake for example is on S3, Parquet or something like that, how mm-hmm. can you partition by user ID?
Well,
or index by user ID?
We are using just folders for each user that we store data in. There are several models that we have holding in every folder for users, so it's pretty easy. Or I don't understand the question correctly.
Because like tens of millions of folders per user? So mm-hmm. that's why, okay.
Yes, in AWS there's unlimited number of, you call it inodes in normal systems, file systems. They don't have such limitations as our computer hard drives. So there can easily be millions of folders.
Thank you.
Yep.
Thanks. Do you train your models online or is just the model serving for the Flink part?
Flink in online model only doing serving through our custom serving service. Model training is done currently periodically in other system. We are just using the same S3 bucket for holding these models. This is the single point of synchronization between those two systems.
Thank you.
Which technology is used for machine learning?
For machine learning, we are using H2O because of the possibility to compile models directly to Java.
You mentioned your focus on removing all the personal data from your input.
Yes.
Have you ever played around with using that input and seeing how your model could or how much it will improve if you were to use the data? Or did you never try that?
Well, we from the beginning started to gather anonymized streams. However, there was some kind of additional information about name of the input box that was data written into. And this additional information was quite helpful. But it was something about 10 to 20% of improvement on the, well, there was impact, it wasn't big.
Hi, thank you for the presentation. How do you update your models during the serving in Flink?
We are not doing this, we are not updating models in Flink. We have another system for that. Flink only connects using asynchronous connections to our serving service.
Oh, okay.
Because we found that holding, there's an idea that hold all your models in Flink state. However, it's not good because state becomes very huge. I know this is the case Flink works towards. However, we found that it's better to move model serving to another system. This is also REST API, our internal REST API, because we can use the same service to developing and finding new models. We just compare our production models in the with the models that we are training right now, and we make the decision. So we don't have to keep two systems for the same thing. We are not using this REST API that we are doing asynchronous requests from Flink to it, only for online processing, but also for model improvement.
Great, thank you.
Are there any other questions from the audience? Perfect. So thanks very much, Sebastian. We will have a lunch break in the parlay between 1 and 2. So we'll see you there. Thank you.